about the grave markers in this part of the cemetery. And I wonder if anyone finds something particularly remarkable. Again, this is the later section, 20th century people here that have been interred then more recently.
They're all Greek descendants.
That's exactly right. So, distinctively Greek surnames here and on the other gravestones. So, typically, searching history, we wouldn't come to the 20th century, but this is where then I'm going to introduce you to the talk from this vantage point, so that we take in that fact that the Greek community has embraced Oak Hill. Well, from here, let's touch on the history as a broader subject, also with the funerary arts. Talk a little bit about those two subjects today as we walk around. And so, if you will, picture a 200-year timeline, going back from the middle of the 1900s, 1950 back. That's essentially what embraces what we think of as Auburn, before that Gough Hill, and the early settlement, even a little earlier than that, right after the Revolution, 1787 and that time, and before that, the native then population here. So it was really an outpost of colonial America or in early America then until the 1820s or so. By then, it was getting ahead of steam and becoming more than settled and civilized. And so I would tell you that by 1850, in that vicinity, the community was bursting at its seams. And it was wanting to push out to develop commercially and residentially. So, in the way of that was the old burying ground on Spring Street. And just where it was, that cemetery was, it's easy for me to tell you that it is where Dairy Joy is now, and the Universalist Church. So that then was in the way of progress. And so, it was brought to those that they were on the board of that cemetery to do something about that, and they purchased then, or saw that this was started at Oak Hill. But it wasn't until in 1865 that the monuments and the tombs had been then moved to Oak Hill. But it's that reason that here, more than you might expect, are then the graves of people that were very much involved in developing our community. And that particularly is in the lower section, and we'll visit some of those folks. Well, the second subject was the change in style. These are modern, largely rather not severe, but plain and square, perhaps, and the but there are styles that we will visit that are more highly decorated. And there were times when symbolism was raging. You know, everything had some sort of design on it. And so, Will, I don't want you to miss that either as we go through, particularly the lower sections. Of course, just to give you a perspective, mankind has been very much interested in recognizing and revering the dead from the earliest of times, case in point, the pyramids, and then more recently, the Mughals in India, with places like the Taj Mahal, its mausoleum, and then even more recently than that, then great churches like St. Peter's in Rome, built on the relics of the saint. Well, by the 1850s, then wonderful places like this then became available, much more popular, and so a much wider and less famous group of people then began to bury their relatives in gardens like this, and a wider range of people in terms of financial abilities. And we'll see that also. So that then, I think, will touch on the two subjects, history and art. And having said that then, let us move to the first site. Very evocative of early 20th century, or if you will, Edwardian style in the first decade or so of the 1900s. It is the resting place of Mayor Albert M. Penley. And Mayor Penley had the distinction of bringing electric light to downtown Auburn. So he changed out the gas lights to electric. His watch was between 1887 and 1889. And up here, by 1888, then he electrified lighting downtown Auburn. He had been successful in business, in the grocery business, made a nice living at that. He then took that money and built a beautiful Victorian home on Main Street at 233 Main Street. And fortunately for us, it is in great shape today and is in fact a bed and breakfast, the Penley House. And the friendly host will be glad to have you make a stop by visit. What really struck me is the beauty also of the interior. The outside is quite charming, but inside it is a work of art in paneling, dark wood stairs, beautiful stained glass window, and so on. Again, very telling of both the amount that he had to spend and of the period of decoration in the late 1800s. So that's the Penley House, the home of Albert M. Penley, former mayor of Auburn. And that is really what I wanted you to get from this little stop. And if you have any questions, just raise your hand. Yes, ma'am.
Is he related to the Penleys that have the Penley Church that's open once a year down over the hill on Riverside?
You know, I'm not sure. When you look at the lists of the people that are interred here, in any given family, there'll be maybe several different heads of household and so on. So, just exactly, and I'll tell you that we have an entire, at the Sargent Historical Site, we have an entire filing cabinet of connections to Penley in Auburn. So there is a good chance that they're related. How closely, I don't know.
Well,
so that's.
So we could probably check there to see if he's a veteran, because he does not have a flag. And we'd like to make sure if he's a veteran, he has a flag.
I don't know that he was. I bet that there are those here who do know. But I don't, that was not part of what came up. It was more mainly his political collections, connections, and his success in the grocery business. All right.
Was he the man who created Penley Meat? Penley Meat?
Well, that's the question too. He came up as a grocer. So whether he had been related business or a relative, I don't know exactly. The whole business story on.
My grandfather worked.
Wonderful. Yeah. So 1887 obviously was a booming grocery store. So whether that became Penley Meats, I don't know. I can tell you that this monument was erected in 1951. Very interestingly, they have taken the a motif that is rather reminiscent of the 1800s, the fern, and placed it on this more modern tomb. So, let's move to Jenna. Gentlemen, it was a matter of my deporting myself in a workmanship-like condition, both as an officer and as a leader of my men, that on August 16th, 1864, I led them at Deep Run Battleground in Virginia. And in so doing, I was harvested from my upper right limb. And because of this, I was breveted to Brigadier General of the 11th Maine Volunteers Infantry, an honor which I accept in both a manner of appreciation and, as you can well imagine, humility. I beg your indulgence and bid you very fond. Like you. So, brevity. It was quite popular in the late Civil War, as officers then were recognized for being part of the progress of the war. It did not include a pay raise, nor added responsibility, more men or anything of nature. It was then a that kind of honorary raise. He was a colonel, and he then got a wound, and of course, as it usually happens, he lost his arm. And so, the general then was cremated in Pennsylvania, and then brought here put in this tomb. But what we do next then is to move down in to the lower section. So as we go down, we go backwards in time.
His forebears and he were Milo.
Yes.
What happened? What was the draw of Auburn?
I suppose that the center of employment, much of me, certainly the chief industry capital of America, and a lot of things were pulled in this direction. Exactly for them, I don't know. But the house was getting as they came to move south. I know that, you know. Why they pulled him back, well, that's because they were interest in our ancestors were on the rise in the 20th century. So they directed this to go to front of the ancestors. But what brought me to my level?
Sure. I noticed the flash by the bottom of the right.
What about it?
The little big monument.
The 11th Regiment, yes, Volunteer Infantry. That is where he was colonel. Is that what you were saying?
I wonder, is the state put these around all the veterans of the 11th? Or?
No, I don't know that. Yes, sir.
Now, you were saying that this
mausoleum
wasn't built in, it wasn't put here in the 50s, it was here well before the 30s, it was well.
All right, well, I read that it was, so thank you, in the 30s, no less.
My dad was caretaker of a cemetery here.
And it was here already.
32, and I was born.
Around
that time when he came to work here.
So
and I so my and yeah, this mausoleum was there when I was here,
so
I've always been.
He was
I've
brought
been inside
here
it,
in 51. Why they would. Maybe they altered it if with his name afterwards.
They may have. I don't remember the name. I didn't. I was 2 years old to 10 years old when I was here. So there's.
And there are other members in there.
Yeah, there are. There's things on either side.
Okay.
I've been inside the.
In the actual tomb of mausoleum.
Perfect. Open, yeah, when it opened.
So constructed earlier.
So it's constructed a good deal earlier.
Yes.
Well before 30.
My understanding is that's when he took residence.
Yeah.
Thank you very much. It wasn't erected in 51.
No,
32.
Before 32, because
even.
It was here in 32. Right? Yeah.
Thank you.
I don't know when it was put. I don't know when it was.
Very good. Well, it's interesting
it was
that fern is also from an earlier period, so I did not hear that it was done earlier, you know, in the earlier century, but that would be a great question to ask. Yes.
When we started, you were carrying a black bag. Did you leave it somewhere?
Yes, with my wife.
Oh, good.
Thank you very much. Yeah.